You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with the second Indo-US 2 plus 2 dialogue held in Washington. Both countries that have already been dealing friendly with each other on multiple fronts agreed to deepen their bilateral cooperation in areas of defense, counter-terrorism and trade. They have also agreed to work with like-minded countries for a free and open Indo-Pacific region. A report.
Indo-US bilateral ties received a two-pronged boost as second 2 plus 2 dialogue was held between the two countries in the US capital, Washington. A host of decisions were taken and multiple others were pondered upon in the meeting that was hosted by Secretary of State Mike Pompeo along with Defense Secretary Mark Esper, who received their Indian counterparts. India and the US have agreed to deepen their bilateral cooperation in areas of defense, counter-terrorism, trade, and to work with the like-minded countries for a free and open Indo-Pacific region. Leaders from two countries acknowledged the principles on which the foundation of the relationship between the two was held.
Our common values of democracy, freedom, respect for the rule of law are a great foundation for our expanding partnership. They're the basis for my hope for a new age of ambition between our two democracies.
Our bilateral trade has registered double-digit growth of late. We have noted very good progress. There are ongoing negotiations on the subject of trade, and I'm very confident that we'll find a balanced outcome that satisfies both sides.
During the dialogue, India and America reaffirmed their commitment to work together in support of a free, open and inclusive Indo-Pacific region. They also agreed to deepen their cooperation to address regional and global threats and to combat terrorism. India, which is one of the largest military spenders across the globe, has US as its principal defense ally. Of late, it has spent a considerable amount to boost its arsenal. The US wants to sell more. Both the countries have together been working on improving their maritime security.
And I'm pleased to report that we continue to make substantial progress in our military relationship. We are taking steps to strengthen our robust maritime partnership and expand our military-to-military cooperation to also include our respective armies, air forces, and special operators.
The two countries have forged a strong partnership on several issues. They're also relentless in strengthening people-to-people ties, including new exchange programs for parliamentarians and young innovators. An improved partnership in the university research and science and technology is also in the pipeline. India's foreign relations are seeing multifold growth since last few decades. While ties with US have become robust in the recent past, India is also looking forward to strengthening relations with its other all-season friends. In a very less span of interval, India has engaged twice into 2 plus 2 meeting. Previous to Washington dialogue, India had earlier hosted a 2 plus 2 meeting with Japan in New Delhi on November 30th. Boosting cooperation in the areas of trade, defense and security remained common issues of discussion in both the meetings.
Moving on. In one more attempt at kick-starting the repatriation process of Rohingya refugees in Bangladesh, a Myanmar delegation recently visited the sprawling camps of Cox's Bazar. This delegation visit, which came at the heels of Aung San Suu Kyi defending her country at the International Court of Justice in The Hague previous week, primarily focused on meeting the Rohingya leaders and trying to convince for return with all Myanmar has to provide. A report.
Having
A Myanmar delegation recently visited Cox's Bazar to negotiate and convince hundreds of thousands of Rohingya refugees languishing in flimsy shelters for more than 2 years. Myanmar says it is ready to facilitate the systematic and smooth return of all Rohingyas. Two attempts have been made in the past as well, but both collapsed owing to refugees growing apprehensive and calling off the deal at the 11th hour. The delegation, however, met them personally this time and explained everything Myanmar wanted to give to the refugees.
We came to the camp to meet with a displaced person from the Rakhine, and we explained the procedures and our effort to repatriate to facilitate the repatriation of the displaced person, and also we explained them the issue relating to the citizenship and NVC and provision of the security arrangement.
Myanmar is a Buddhist majority where Rohingya live in its northern border. They describe themselves as descendants of Arab traders who settled in the region many generations ago. Myanmar does not consider the Rohingya a native ethnic group. Many in the Buddhist majority country call the Rohingyas Bengalis, suggesting they belong in Bangladesh.
Based on the legal facts and historical facts, we explain them the reason we could not accept the usage of the Rohingya. But we didn't deny the existence of their communities.
The extensive talks on day one could not hit a deal. However, both the sides were hopeful of striking a breakthrough in the coming time. Rohingyas say they would return if Myanmar government agrees to their demand, which include citizenship and a government job.
Ara eda chide ede aja meeting kori ulo hod barmatun manusher hod hunni te hi anolla ta ara kibabo da heri mare barma da bola ara to yera si kengri ara da heri undi ara khokna ara kengri fai undi ara kengri ara her da si thai heri undi yan ara yan alla saibolla uli achide.
Gambia accused Myanmar of violating the 1948 Genocide Convention over a military campaign that drove more than 730,000 Rohingya Muslims from Myanmar to Bangladesh. It has asked the International Court of Justice to order provisional measures to prevent more harm. Aung San Suu Kyi, however, has denied all charges previous week and accused Gambia of presenting misinformation before the Apex International Court. She had also urged ICJ to drop all charges Myanmar being held accountable to.
Moving on to Pakistan, where the former military ruler Parvez Musharraf has been convicted guilty and sentenced to death by an anti-terrorism court for the act of treason. Parvez Musharraf has, however, called it a vendetta, citing only few people were involved in this complete exercise. He is also confident that he would be free of all charges in the higher courts. Former PM Nawaz Sharif, whom the general had deposed in 1999 through a military coup, initiated a treason trial against Musharraf on returning to power in 2013. A report.
In a rare of case of a judicial blow to powerful army of Pakistan, former army general and president of the country, Parvez Musharraf, was convicted in absentia of high treason and subversion of constitution by an anti-terrorism court in Islamabad. In November 2007, Musharraf suspended the constitution and imposed emergency rule. He resigned in 2008 to avoid the threat of impeachment. When Nawaz Sharif, an old rival whom he deposed in the 1999 coup, was elected Prime Minister in 2013, he initiated a treason trial against Musharraf, and in 2014, the former general was charged for high treason. Post-retirement, Musharraf has spent large part of his life outside the country. A lift-in travel ban in 2016 allowed him to receive medical treatment in Dubai, and since then he has been there only. Despite multiple orders, he has refused to appear before the court. Calling it a conspiracy of selected few, Musharraf on a hospital bed in Dubai said that law was being misused by a group of people and they were doing out of enmity.
मैं इस फैसले को मशकूक इसलिए कहता हूं कि कानून की बलदस्ती को इस केस की सुनवाई में शुरू से लेकर आखिर तक ख्याल नहीं रखा गया। ये केस सिर्फ कुछ लोगों की मेरे खिलाफ जाती अदावत की वजह से इस केस को टेकअप किया गया और सुना गया और ये एक फर्द वाहिद को टारगेट किया गया और उन लोगों ने टारगेट किया जो ऊंचे ओहदों पे फाइज हैं और अपने ओहदे की गलत इस्तेमाल करते हैं कानून का मायूस कुन इस्तेमाल फर्द वाहिद को निशाना बनाना और वाकयात का अपनी मंशा के मुताबिक चुनाव करना ये जाहिर करता है कि ये लोग क्या चाहते हैं
The final years of his rule were marked by struggles with the judiciary stemming from his wish to remain head of the army while also being president. Musharraf resigned in 2008 after a political party that backed him fared poorly in a general election. The lawyers of Musharraf are planning to file an appeal which the Imran administration has no intention of opposing.
ये केस गलत है और 10 दफा कहा है कि केस गलत है इस केस के साथ दूसरे केस भी गलत है जब सेक्रेटरी इंटीरियर को कैबिनेट के अप्रूवल लेके तब ये दायर करनी चाहिए और परवेज मुशर्रफ ने जो 3 नवंबर 2007 की इमरजेंसी लगाई है वो ऑन द एडवाइस ऑफ प्राइम मिनिस्टर और विद द कंसल्टेशन ऑफ एवरीबॉडी ऑल द स्टेक होल्डर्स और कैबिनेट की एडवाइस के ऊपर वो जो है एक्ट उठाया था वो उस वक्त मुल्क की हक में था वो उस वक्त मुल्क के हक में था तमाम लोगों ने उसको हेल किया है एक्सेप्ट वन ग्रुप और ये केस गलत है जितनी जनरल परवेज मुशर्रफ ने इस मुल्क के अंदर तरक्की दी है जितनी कानून को इज्जत दी है आप लोगों को मीडिया को जितनी इज्जत दी है आज तक किसी ने नहीं दी
Pakistan Army has directly ruled Pakistan for a significant period since it was formed in 1947. Generals have framed hardline laws and have deflected the discourse towards fundamentalism. From Zia-ul-Haq to Pervez Musharraf, everybody has tired the society with Islamic fundamentalism. While some in the society are now hailing the judicial courage, others have expressed doubt, citing actions being taken to prevent blacklisting by Financial Action Task Force.
The face of Pakistan gets exposed when we move just few miles away from its favorite province, Punjab. Today, we'll focus on its nefarious agenda of changing the status of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, POK. Speculations to this effect gained momentum when POK government renamed Azad Jammu and Kashmir Management Group as Jammu and Kashmir Administrative Services. Political activists from POK have condemned this move by Islamabad. A report.
After remaining under illegal occupation for over 7 decades, Pakistan-occupied Kashmir is hinted out to be merged with Punjab and Khyber Pakhtunkhwa provinces of Pakistan. An order dated 11th December, issued by Azad Government of the State of Jammu and Kashmir, Services and General Administration Department Regulations, said the President of Azad Jammu and Kashmir ordered renaming of Azad Jammu and Kashmir Management Group as Jammu and Kashmir Administrative Services with immediate effect. The order was issued just a couple of days after POK Prime Minister Raja Farooq Haider Khan said in Muzaffarabad that he could be the last Prime Minister of POK, dropping enough hints that Pakistan could alter the status of POK. Khan's statement had drawn flake from several POK leaders who had opposed the sinister plan of Pakistan to fiddle with the status of POK, which was an autonomous territory held illegally by Pakistan as it was part and parcel of India.
پاکستان کے جو زیر انتظام کشمیر ہے آزاد کشمیر جس کو کہتے ہیں اس کے پرائم منسٹر راجہ فاروق حیدر صاحب نے یہ کہا ہے کہ پاکستان کے حساس اداروں نے مجھے ایک واضح پیغام دے دیا ہے کہ آپ اس ایریے کے آخری پرائم منسٹر ہیں اور اس کے بعد یہاں پہ کوئی پرائم منسٹر نہیں آئے گا یعنی کہ پاکستان سیریسلی پاکستانی اکیوپائڈ کشمیر جس کو آزاد کشمیر کہتے ہیں اس کا مرجر آزاد پنجاب کی تحصیلوں اور ضلعوں میں کرنا چاہتا ہے اور کے پی کے کے ضلعوں میں اور اسی طرح گلگت بلتستان کے مرجر کے حوالے سے بھی ان کی کہیں نہ کہیں اندرون خانہ ایک منصوبہ انہوں نے بنا رکھا ہے.
Since its illegal occupation, Pakistan has played politics over POK by calling it Azad or free. The recent order has exposed the real face of Pakistan and its hidden agenda over Kashmir. Although Pakistan never had a legal claim over the illegally occupied territories of Gilgit-Baltistan and POK, the unscrupulous administrators from Islamabad have violated human rights by persecuting the locals through draconian laws.
وہ ٹی وی چینلوں پہ بیٹھ کے سرعام کہتے ہیں کہ ہاں جی ان ایریاز کو تو ہم نے لبریٹ کرایا, ہم نے تو دوسرے بھی لینے تھے, چلو وہ تو نہیں لے پائے لیکن اب ان کا مرجر ہمیں کر لینا چاہیے. جو پنجاب کے صوبے ہیں, تحصیلیں ہیں مختلف, ان میں اور یا کے پی کے ساتھ جو ایریاز لگتے ہیں تو ان کو کے پی کے میں مرج کر لیتے ہیں, اور گلگت بلتستان کے حوالے سے بھی دیکھتے ہیں کہ کیا سٹ اپ بنایا جائے, یعنی کہ ان دونوں ایریاز کو وہ بائی آرز مین پاکستان میں مرج کرنا چاہتے ہیں اور انہوں نے ایک منصوبہ بندی کمپلیٹ کر لی ہے. پاکستان کا اسٹیٹ آف جموں اینڈ کشمیر پہ کوئی لوکل اسٹینڈ آئی نہیں تھا, لیگل ان کی کوئی کلیم نہیں بنتا تھا, الیگل اکوپائر تھے, اگریسر تھے یو این کی جو ریزولیشنز ہیں ان کے مطابق بھی, لیکن انفارچونیٹلی جو کشمیری مذہب کے نام پہ بلیک میل ہوئے ان کے ہاتھوں میں کھیلتے رہے, انہوں نے 1,00,000 کشمیریوں کو قربان کروایا, ان کی ماؤں سے اپنے بچے چھنوائے اور بے شمار چھوٹے بچوں کو یتیم کروایا, تو آج اگر کوئی مذہب ملک ہو تو ان پہ وار کرمینل کا کیس بنتا ہے انٹرنیشنل کرمینل کورٹ میں.
پاکستان لیڈرشپ مائٹ ٹرائی ٹو مرج پی او کے وتھ خیبر پختونخوا وچ شیئرڈ بارڈر وتھ پی او کے ایز ویل ایز گلگت بلتستان اور میک اٹ اے ففتھ پروونس الانگ وتھ بلوچستان, Punjab, Sindh and Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, which was till 2010 known as Northwestern Frontier Province. Since its occupation, Pakistan has misused the territories of POK and Gilgit-Baltistan by not only exploiting its land and resources but allowing China to foray in. The people of POK and Gilgit-Baltistan have been fighting against forceful occupation of their territory.
Now we take you to Nepal, where India continues to assist in rebuilding the areas destructed during April 2015 earthquake. Besides structural reconstruction, India is also emphasizing on social reformation of the victims. The reconstruction in Nepal is providing employment opportunities to Nepalese women in the country. We have a report.
Radha Ramtel, a resident of Gorkha, is now working at a reconstruction site where the 2015 earthquake laid its epicenter. She has been working along with 8 other women who got into work of construction after attending training provided by United Nations Development Programme Nepal, which has undertaken Nepal Housing Reconstruction Project funded by the Government of India.
पहिले सुरुमा भूकम्प जाँदा त एउटा गोठ थियो त्यसमा गएर सबै दाजुभाइले राख्नु भयो त्यसपछि पाल दिनु भयो पाल बाडेर बस्यो अनि अब फेरि भूकम्प जाँदै गर्दा अब घर बनाउने धेरै उ त भएन चा धेरै छिटो त घर त बनेन अब पछिपछि घर बन्दै जस्तो बारेर बस्यो
Ramtail has shifted to a new house as per regulation of the government of Nepal that demands house to be earthquake resilient one amongst a lot of the clauses.
अहिले भूकम्प रोहित घर दुईटा कोठा बनेको छ ठिकै छ बस्न लायकको छ भूकम्प रोहित घर भूकम्पलाई झेल्ने घर बनाइएको छ बच्चाबच्ची सहित छन्
The Indian government is helping to construct some 50,000 houses in Nepal, which will benefit 26,912 beneficiaries in Gorkha and 23,088 beneficiaries in Nuwakot districts. The government has appointed UNDP and United Nations Office for Project Services as socio-technical facilitation consultants for reconstruction.
जस्तै हामी आउनभन्दा पहिला उहाँहरू पनि तालिम प्राप्त त तालिम प्राप्तै हुनुहुन्थ्यो कोही कोही चाहिँ धेरै जस्ट 50% जति हामीले अहिले जति कभर गरिरहेको छौँ त्यसमा 50% जति तालिम प्राप्तै हुनुहुन्थ्यो तालिम प्राप्त भए पनि उहाँहरू काममा चाहिँ अलिकति सानोतिनो मिस्टेकहरू जस्तै बन्धन बनाउने कुरामा गाह्रो लगाउने कुरा मसला बनाउने कुरामा चाहिँ अलिकति कमजोरी देखिएको थियो त्यही कमजोरीलाई चाहिँ छोपाउनको लागि चाहिँ हामीले चाहिँ रिफ्रेसर जस्तै एक दिनै ट्रेनिङ जहाँ अन साइड काम भइरहेको हुन्छ त्यहाँ गएर चाहिँ हामीले चाहिँ उहाँहरूलाई सुधार्न उनीहरूको गल्तीहरूलाई सुधार्नको लागि चाहिँ हामीले चाहिँ उहाँ गएर चाहिँ प्र्याक्टिकल सहित काम गरेर सिकायो ट्रेनिङ दिइरहेको हुन्छ
The reconstruction drive initiated by the government of India in earthquake affected areas of Nepal has brought happiness for the beneficiaries. India has been actively rebuilding schools, roads, hospitals as well as some key heritage sites that were devastated in the 2015 earthquake.
Other than language, religion and culture, food is a quintessential element that defines any given geographical location on earth. Recently, Northeast Food Innovation Exhibition 2019 was celebrated in Meghalaya's capital city, Shillong. It was one such event that brought delicacies from across the borders to cater to the food-loving nation, India. The food exhibition saw more than 300 delegates from across the globe and sectors, including entrepreneurs, farmers and chefs. Let's take a look.
Food is the very essence of the culture of people living across the globe. From ages, the kitchens of northeastern states have hooked foodies, churning out a wide range of aromatic dishes with all kinds of flavors. To showcase the goodness of food of Northeast, Meghalaya hosted the first ever biggest food innovation exhibition. The food show organized by the Meghalaya government in collaboration with CL Group, the Northeast Food Show 2019, was a food innovation and food processing show and the first of its kind in Northeastern India that is focused on creating a global platform to inspire food business for this part of the country. More than 5,000 visitors were seen thronging one of the biggest food festivals ever.
We are very happy to be here in Shillong, in Meghalaya, for this first Northeast Food Show. And you know, India is a crucial partner for us, so we've launched CL India in New Delhi, and we have also this show here now. So that's first time ever that we have two CL shows here in India. So we are looking forward to this program.
Unique cuisines and ingredients commonly used in northeastern kitchens were exhibited during the food show, which acted as a platform for the industries to elevate their products and services through collaborations with national and global processing and packaging units and industry experts. This exciting event is the region's premier and dedicated B2B platform that is aimed at marrying together with the best of the Northeast with the best of the food and food processing world.
India is a mixed bowl of sweet, sour and spicy flavors. Each part of the country has a different cuisine and its own unique set of flavors. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
You're watching Tag TV.